Coming up on the Doctors Hospital podcast.
Rather, we have a very high incidence of substance use in the Bahamas, be it alcohol, marijuana, cocaine, and now we have some newer substances coming into town.
Experience the immediate care you deserve at Doctors Hospital Urgent Care. When emergency strikes, trust our expert physicians for fast, quality care. With extended hours and cutting-edge medical technology, we're always ready to serve you. Don't wait or take risks with your health. Visit our urgent care suite at Doctors Hospital West on Blake Road for immediate, trusted, and best care.
Welcome to the Doctors Hospital podcast. I am your host, Alexis Burrows, marketing director here at Doctors Hospital. And for those of you in our listening audience, if you don't know, May is celebrated every year as Mental Health Awareness Month, both in the Bahamas and across the world. And so this month, we are featuring two podcasts talking about mental health, one from the viewpoint of a psychiatrist and one from the viewpoint of a psychologist. So today we are joined by none other than our very own psychiatrist, Dr. Boda. Welcome to the show, Dr. Boda. We're happy to have you here.
Thank you. Good afternoon. And happy to be here.
Awesome. So we are going to go through a very interesting discussion, kind of just talking through what mental health looks like from your perspective. Obviously, someone with a lot of experience in the space, I'm very interested to get your take on some of the common misconceptions and just giving us some general information about mental health disorders. So to start off with, you know, how did you decide to get into psychiatry in the first place?
Very interesting question at this stage in the game. Well, I was always attracted to people with disabilities, even growing up. And although I wanted to become a surgeon, I went into the surgical field. But something guided me always towards people with disabilities.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how I kind of discovered that I should do psychiatry.
Okay.
And I had very good mentors who guided me in that direction. So it was not a very difficult choice. It was almost like a first choice for me since the days, my very early days.
Okay, awesome. You know, I think we hear so many different terminologies thrown around nowadays about a number of different mental health disorders, things like that. But you can you give us an overview of some of the most common disorders that you come into contact with in our environment, you know, kind of go through some of the symptoms and how you would go about diagnosing a patient?
That's very broad and very general question. To zero that for you, first, we can establish some understanding what are mental disorders, mental health problems. Well, taking the WHO definition, a mental disorder is anything that causes significant clinical disturbances in somebody's day-to-day life, which involves your emotional balance, your thoughts, how you approach your problems in life, day-to-day life, okay, and your job, your relationships. Any significant distress or an impairment in this is basically defined as a mental disorder or mental health concern or a problem.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, keeping in view or keeping consistent with these kind of broad definition or outlines, there are lots of definitions, lots of mental disorders which have been defined, and for the sake of definitions and for the clarity of putting people in boxes so that we can approach treatments and help that could be available. So yes, worldwide, there are lots of mental health challenges, mental health disorders. Things have gotten worse over the last 5-6 years. Mm-hmm. People are spiraled off, be it the pandemic and ongoing wars in this world, the recessions, etc. All right. These are the broad general risk factors we're talking about. And besides the various other and local environmental factors that also influence our definitions, our approach to life. And sometimes some of us deal with problems in the way they should be dealt with. Some of us have a difficulty coping a lot of times.
Mm-hmm.
So any impairment, any dysfunction in our ability to cope and our ability to move on from the distress that we experience defines or characterizes mental illness. Okay. Well, the WHO has said that almost these days, one in every eight individuals suffers from some kind of disability.
Wow.
Yes. And this has mushroom or ballooned since ever since the pandemic worldwide. And we are no exception. The Bahamas had gone through some very serious, troubling times. First, we had the Hurricane Dorian.
Mm-hmm.
And very soon after, I mean, I think we went into a kind of recession, I guess. We are still in it. People have lost their jobs. And then very soon, the pandemic followed. So just like every other part of the world, you know, how did we face all these problems? How are we bouncing back?
Mm-hmm.
You know, some of us are still struggling with these, whatever that is, our quality of life or rather our the way we approach life has kind of changed. So some did well, some not doing too well. So we are not an exception to the general mental health disorders.
Mm-hmm.
You know, top of the list worldwide, usually the most common general mental health disorders are usually anxiety disorders, always, you know. Depression, major depression is another big mental illness concern all over the world. And we are no exception to that, okay? Worldwide, if we have to take since 2019, I think they estimate about 300 million people struggling or living with anxiety disorders.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, that's a huge. And same with depression, that has simply ballooned worldwide. I'm looking at about 280 to 300 million people have been diagnosed or on treatments or getting interventions in some form or the other, you know. And then you have the very basic, not basic, the what defines psychiatric disorders in a common, in a common man's understanding are the bipolar disorders, the schizophrenias, you know. They're always around.
Mm-hmm.
And then the challenges with substance abuse related disorders. Okay. And then we, of course, the other things like neurodevelopmental disorders, learning disorders, you know.
Right.
So we're no exception if you really have to talk about it to the general psychiatric illnesses that we are exposed to.
Mm-hmm.
But of major concern, if you ask me to pick the top two or three disorders in the Bahamas, I would say anxiety.
Mm-hmm.
Depression and substance abuse.
Okay.
You know?
Makes sense.
And which takes a toll on our healthcare system day to day, and as well as our general life, our population.
So you mentioned a number of disorders there. And I know, you know, we live in an environment where, you know, there's more education and there's more information out there about the various disorders. But I still think that we live in a space where there are a lot of misconceptions and myths surrounding mental health disorders. What would you say are some of those that you encounter frequently? And what would you say to our audience to kind of dispel some of those myths or misconceptions around mental health disorders and their treatment?
Well, the biggest myth or stumbling block for most for us in the mental health care facilities or as a professional is stigma.
Mm-hmm.
If you call that a myth, well, then be it. You know, that first step. Most people are afraid if you call someone having an anxiety disorder,
or
major depression, they're scared of that label. They don't want to be labeled all their lives. And rightly so, you know, in a small community, in a small society, things have a way of going in all directions, whether you like it or not. And very soon you're being labeled.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And the next biggest misconception is, oh, it cannot be treated, cannot be helped.
Mm-hmm.
Or I'm going to get hooked to medications or treatments, you know? So people are reluctant to seek treatments and get help at the right time. And a lot of times these, when you don't get help at the right time, just like imagine any other generalized medical disorder, mental health itself is a generalized medical disorder. You know, you don't treat your diabetes in time, you don't treat your hypertension in time, it's going to cost you.
That is correct.
All right, with various other issues. Same way with mental health disorders. It has to be approached in the right amount and the right time frame.
Mm-hmm.
And the treatment has to be defined appropriately. And I'm sure anybody can be helped. So I think the biggest stumbling block is our stigma in this community, being a small community.
Mm-hmm.
You know, As far as myths are concerned, well, there's so many myths around that float around. Sometimes think it's, spiritual topics. I mean, spirituality always reigns top in the Bahamas. You know, everybody has that theory about it, right? And they go to preachers, and I have no problem with that, considering. But you have to also involve your psychiatrist at some point. I mean, a professional.
Right.
You know, besides not just using the, you know, your preacher man or your OBO man.
Right.
Believe it or not, OBO is still big in the Bahamas,
mm-hmm.
you know, in certain communities. That also becomes a big stumbling block to accessing care, you know. So, yeah, so the biggest issue for me is, as in my practice, is the stigma.
Yeah.
You know, and having the confidentiality issues.
Right.
A lot of times people are afraid for these challenges and for these kind of problems.
Mm-hmm.
They don't like to come out. They're not brave enough to come out and say, hey, I went to see Dr. Boda yesterday.
Right.
Or I went to see a so-and-so psychiatrist. Mm-hmm. You know, we don't discuss these things. We are afraid to talk about even with our own family members.
Right.
Because of the stigma of being labeled and being judged. A lot of times. So those are some biggest huge stumbling blocks as far as treatment issues are concerned, as well as getting help at the right time,
right?
Also is concerned.
You know, we've been doing the podcast very consistently over the past few months. And I think that's something that seems to be a consistent point, no matter what the area of discussion is that, you know, the earlier you can find something out or figure something out or discover it, the better positioned you are to get help and to get treatment. And you know, it goes straight across the board, whether it's something with your physical body or with your mental health. You mentioned stigma, which obviously is a big one, but what other cultural or societal factors influence the perception and treatment of mental health issues?
Well, the treatment is basically, I mean, it's also again multifactorial. A lot of times, people think that once you diagnose, you're stuck with it all your life. It is something that you can't shake off, you know. So that itself is a big stumbling block for treatments to be instituted or even continued or debated upon, you know. And we prefer to struggle in our minds. We prefer to put up this psychological battles and go through the stress every day rather than trying to go make that brave move to go walk into a psychiatrist's office or a psychologist and ask for help. And that has not changed over the years. I've been practicing psychiatry almost 25 years in the Bahamas. And that is it's very difficult to penetrate that barrier. And no matter what class or strata of society it is, unless we see violence, unless we see someone walking naked on the street,
right,
we're not going to intervene.
Okay. Amy, you talked about a little bit already about early intervention, but, you know, if you were to give someone advice to say, you know, these are some of the warning signs you should look out for that might be indicative of something being awry with your mental health, what are some warning signs people should look out for?
Warning signs usually start with behavioral changes.
Okay.
Let's say your brother, your father, your mother, or your sibling, somebody who's very bubbly, who's very active and, you know, or rather has certain demeanors and any sudden change, a soft signs and changes in these, suddenly getting snappy or suddenly getting withdrawn, you know, these are all warning signs, basically, or eating out of character or not eating at all, and not taking care of oneself, like bathing, personal hygiene. Your room is dirty, all we do is shower, why is it so nasty, you know? And these are some of the very soft, fighting always, arguing a lot, you know, which doesn't make sense, you know, losing jobs, changing jobs frequently, and not going to work, getting up and going to work, and rather you're shopping around for doctor's six lips, you know, is another warning signs of all is not well.
Right.
Okay. You know, or sometimes we turn to the substances. We have a large population in the Bahamas, or rather we have a very high incidence of substance use in the Bahamas, be it alcohol, marijuana, okay, cocaine, and now we have some newer substances coming into town in play. So then someone turning using these things also is a huge warning sign, as right. far as I'm concerned, that all is not well.
Mm-hmm.
And this person can be helped or should be helped. And it's also, the problem will also be, like you've talked about, myths and
misconceptions.
Mm-hmm. It's also, how do we approach these individuals? A lot of times we don't like to confront with somebody with this information or your observations. We wait for everything to fall, you know, until things go really wrong.
Mm-hmm.
So we shouldn't be waiting for that long, that length of period. It's always important to have a conversation. It's always important to encourage people. Let's go see a psychiatrist, or let's go see at least a psychologist, a counselor, somebody who's connected with mental health, work sometime.
Mm-hmm.
That helps. And fortunately, the Bahamas is well organized in the mental health concern area, especially the public sector is pretty well organized,
mm-hmm.
you know, and the schools are pretty well decent. I mean, I wouldn't say well staffed, but decently staffed with counselors,
mm-hmm.
and most nurses who work there have some kind of background training, etc., in mental health topics and observing for changes in behaviors and concerns.
Okay. Awesome. So very good conversation thus far, Dr. Boda. We're going to take a quick break and then we'll be right back on the Doctors Hospital podcast.
Your health just got brighter with Lamp Insured. Sign up for Doctors Hospital's Lamp Insurance Supplement Plan and enjoy copay waivers and complete access with no upfront ER or inpatient collections. Only $30 per month. Visit doctorshosp.com/lamp to sign up or contact 242-822-1009. That's 242-822-1009. Your journey to affordable and worry-free healthcare begins now.
Welcome back to the Doctors Hospital podcast. We are continuing our conversation on mental health awareness with Dr. Boda. So you mentioned, getting help. I think one of the things that people oftentimes may have concerns about, and I think you talked about this a little bit when you were talking about the misconceptions and the myths as well, is, you know, what are the treatment options if I'm diagnosed with anxiety or depression or any of the other mental health disorders that are out there. How do you go about determining, what is the best approach for an individual patient? And then what are some of the common treatment options or the most effective treatment options for some of the ones that you've mentioned, like anxiety, like depression?
Well, we can spend a whole day talking about these things. Sorry about that. Well, at the outset, like I said, there's plenty of help available in the Bahamas. Fortunately, we're one of the small few countries where we have developed our mental health facilities, mm-hmm. our access to mental health. Most people may or may not know that. We have lots of clinics open,
mm-hmm.
and we have well-trained psychiatrists, whether you believe it or not, almost close to 25.
Mm.
Trained, certified psychiatrists, okay, and lots of psychologists. So we run a lot of programs out in the community, mm-hmm. in terms of education, okay. And treatments have improved a lot over the years, and where disorders, if correctly diagnosed, can be specifically targeted.
Mm-hmm.
Various symptoms can be specifically targeted, and medication has become, in case we are talking about medication, it's pretty accurate in terms of targeting your symptoms.
Mm-hmm.
You know, yeah, you may have to, just like any other medical disorder, you may have to experiment with one or two drugs or pharmaceuticals before it has an impact.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and even before you reach that far, like I said, you're well endowed with a lot of treatment professionals. Namely, the counselors, psychologists, okay? But with anxiety disorders, we have a lot of training,
mm-hmm.
how to deal with your stressors, how to deal with your anxiety, coping skills. Okay, we have what is called the Community Counseling Psychiatry Center,
mm-hmm.
right across Doctors Hospital. That's a public area, public clinic,
mm-hmm.
okay? And then I'm sure Doctors Hospital now has incorporated about three other psychiatrists as well. We're all open for consultations.
Mm-hmm.
And all the time. But Yes, as far as the mental health has made significant strides in terms of addressing various psychological issues. It's not like the good old days, and in the good day, old days where we didn't know what we're dealing with, and the number of treatment options were very minimum.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, but lots of money has been pumped into mental health over the years, and strengthening the infrastructure has happened all over the place. And the Bahamas can take pride in that. We have spent a lot of money on strengthening up basic foundations of mental health. Accessibility, I mean.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And our medications are there and our pharmacies are decently and well stocked in case. So price is not a problem. People can't say, oh, it's too expensive. I can't afford my medication.
Mm.
That should not be an excuse.
Right.
To anybody who wants to access mental health treatments.
Right.
Okay.
Okay. Awesome. So, Dr. Bodo, one of the things I think anybody, if you watch television, if you engage on social media, there's been a lot of ads for telehealth and online resources for mental health, a lot of different platforms out there that exist. how do you see the landscape of mental health treatment evolving, given some of those options that are out there, and then even just how it applies to you in your practice?
Well, COVID has always pushed us into new realms of telehealth, and not just mental health. Basically, telehealth on the whole has taken off.
Mm-hmm.
And mental health is not an exception to that. And mental health, and in particular, has really adopted this new alternate form of communication, or rather treatment or assessments.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And for example, I could be sitting in the Bahamas and I can address a patient somewhere in China,
mm-hmm.
as long as I can be able to set it up, right? And we had taken advantage of this. Even before all this came in my early training days at Sandlands, we used to use Skype to communicate with out-island patients. I remember going there for one after post-hurricane and, usual post-mental health, hurricane mental health check, and we had identified a lots of patients who needed to be followed up and who needed to be treated. But we can't bring all of them to Nassau, Bahamas, right?
Right.
So there was two nurses there on the island who were particularly concerned, who were well trained. And we had used Skype. We set it up in our offices. And we had used Skype with great efficacy. I mean, it's not the same as... That's very rudimentary, really ask me, you know. But again, it gave us some idea.
Mm-hmm.
And now, the way telehealth has evolved is phenomenal.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's there. The technology is there. And as far as the diagnostic codes, everything is in place. And a lot of patients also prefer telehealth instead of coming into... During COVID, at least, mm-hmm. a lot of them preferred to actually sit in their homes and have their consultations,
mm-hmm.
which we did with great efficacy with using Zoom platforms. But now I'm sure it has mushroomed into something more.
Yeah, because I mean, I imagine it's a space too where, again, given the stigma, if you feel more comfortable doing that, you know, from the privacy of, mm-hmm. you know, your home or somewhere where you don't necessarily have to be seen, because we do have that issue with stigma. Where you don't have to be seen walking into the office, so to speak, then I'm sure that would be something that people, you know, still would be interested in, even as the pandemic, you know, we've shifted away from that. But obviously that was the driving factor for the explosion of it. I didn't know you guys were using Skype for that. You know, I guess it makes sense, though, especially with the way we're set up as an archipelago. It definitely would make access to care a lot easier. And like you've indicated, and we've seen even in our own space, that expansion of what you're capable of doing with telehealth, both in with your physical body, but as well with your mental health as well. So, you know, I think one of the things that a lot of people would like to hear and understand, especially if they feel like they might, you know, be in that early stages of they see a slight change in their behavior and they're concerned. What are some self-care practices or strategies that people can incorporate into their life to support their mental well-being? So, you know, things that kind of keep you from cracking, so to speak.
To finish off our conversation and telehealth,
mm-hmm.
So right now, there's so many Bahamians who actually seek care via telehealth abroad. I have patients and who come, I mean, just for prescriptions now and then. But they say, oh, don't worry about my diagnosis. Don't worry about anything else. I have my own therapist. Where is this therapist? Somewhere in California or Seattle.
Right.
You know, and it's easy to communicate as well with these therapists. There's no stumbling blocks. So, well, yes, telehealth holds great promise as far as mental health is concerned, telemental health. Once we can get it well organized and set up, and our patients and large majority of our patients can actually buy into it. You know, and it's also come down to resources and stuff like that. So I think we're moving in the right direction. I'm seeing probably in the next 5 years it should balloon.
Even further.
So, and coming to your self-care practices or strategies. Well, one, I always tell people, you have to love yourself.
Okay.
You have to put yourself in front of everything that you do. Okay. Be it your work, be it your personal life, your friends. Okay. And once you identify what you can do and what you cannot do, none of us are invincible. We all need to have those do's, don'ts lists in our day-to-day life, in our weekly life, in our month. That's how I tell people, one day at a time.
Right.
And that's how you approach everything, you know. You take care of the day, it takes care of the week, it takes care of the month and the year. That's how life rolls. So we all have to have some realistic goals, realistic expectations. Cannot believe that we are supermen, superwomen, you know. So planning your day-to-day life, your activities helps a lot. Well, things may fall in place, may not fall in place. That's a different matter. But as long as you have a day-to-day plan in action, it solves a lot of the stress. It takes away the uncertainty of your day, you know, and it helps you to move in different directions. You can't expect the minute you leave your house, you step into your car, you don't know what's going to happen. Okay? But as long as you have a plan, what you're planning and where you're going and how you're going, it helps. I'm not saying that's an absolute map set in stone, but it helps.
It's like a starting point.
Yeah, a starting point. Same way when you approach your work. What is it that I can do? What is it I cannot do? You know, you have to be very clear in your mind and you have to be able to communicate, you know, with your colleagues, with your peers, with your supervisors. Okay. And above all, rest, sleep is extremely important. We totally underestimate the therapeutic benefits and properties of sleep. Most of us spend our life in insomnia. We do not get good quality sleep. I mean, there's some people who are out there absolutely blessed, you know. And they can sleep for 6 to 8 hours easily. Okay, and people often ask me, what is appropriate amount of sleep? How many hours? If you ask me, restful sleep, 6 hours is decent. It's pretty good, if you ask me. Eight hours is a luxury these days. If you're a working person and an individual, you have a family to run. And 8 hours sleep is becoming a luxury of late. Okay? So at least even if you can knock the 6 hours sleep into your system, into your body, you're ahead of the game. You know? And good diet practices help a lot. Again, approach to diet, there has to be a plan. You can't just jump into your car and drive around looking for food.
Right.
I mean, I'm not saying enough. Back to your whole hunting ways. In other words, we're just hunting in a different way. You know?
Right.
You're getting into a car and you're shopping around from fast food to fast food. So food is very important. What we're eating, what we put in our body. Some of the foods that processed foods can absolutely make us lethargic and, you know, can spoil your day most times, give you less energy. You know, so energy producing foods, very important. Snacking frequently is important. That is the secret probably to improve your metabolism as well as also take care of your stressors. High energy foods and fruits and nuts have to be incorporated.
I was going to say, let's make sure we're indicating that it's healthy snacks.
Very healthy snacks.
Not marshmallows and potato chips.
Definitely not. No, not those potato chips. Healthy snacks. You have to incorporate drinking plenty fluids every day and watching your intake of, I won't advocate zero tolerance or complete abstinence,
mm-hmm.
but you have to know your limits as to how much of alcohol you can and what you need it for.
Right.
And, you know, we are an alcoholic country.
Mm-hmm.
If you really ask me, everybody drinks. You go to someone's house, the first thing they'll offer you is a glass of beer.
Mm-hmm.
They won't ask you, do you want some water?
Glass of beer, glass of wine.
Glass of wine.
Right.
Okay. So we can't do nothing about that. That's the culture.
Mm-hmm.
All right. And but we have to watch.
Yeah.
Those calories is important. So this is very simple stuff. Organization, you know, knowing when to putting boundaries in your life. Okay. Knowing your strengths and weaknesses is extremely important all the time. Sleep, good habits in terms of substance uses, etc.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah, I think the food one is an interesting one because I don't think people talk about that enough. The connection between what we eat and how that affects our mental state. Because you mentioned lethargy, obviously is one of them. But yeah, I think that's something that people should kind of, you know, take particular note to. As to what you eat and how that impacts you, not just physically, but your overall body as well. Okay, so very good conversation. I think just final thing is, you know, what advice would you give to someone who thinks that they may be struggling with their mental health, but they feel hesitant to seek help?
Difficult question. Like we discussed earlier, people struggling with this always have some misperceived misconceptions
mm-hmm.
about being judged, afraid to seek help. And that prevails amongst most medical conditions. You know, you're afraid to be diagnosed, you're mm-hmm. afraid to be labeled a diabetic, hypertensive, and mental health disorders is no exception. You just have to make that first move. Always talk to a good friend that you have.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? And always know the information as to where exactly are the clinics, where exactly in this town, in Nassau,
mm-hmm.
or in the outer islands, or in the clinics, Freeport, wherever we are. And we had a very interesting quick chat on telehealth.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't want to come out of your house to see your psychiatrist or your psychologist, go online. There's so much information out there, and there's so many other professionals. Don't be burdened.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, make that first move. Then they may advise you, you know, you need to go see a psychiatrist.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and there's no dearth of psychiatrists in the Bahamas. Like I said, there are at least 25 trained ones and spread in different directions. Cost is not always a problem. Okay. And we mental health professionals are quite inexpensive in this country.
Mm.
We have not reached those international standards where it charges thousands of dollars.
Right.
You know, if not, well, there are community clinics. A lot of community clinics are staffed with psychiatrists. Mm-hmm. Every single community clinic in the Bahamas has psychiatric service. Okay. I can tell you that. That's one thing we have done very well.
Mm-hmm.
Community mental health psychiatry. And very robust programs they have for all kinds of psychological disorders. There's counseling available free, almost. Well-trained psychologists. Okay. And Doctors Hospital is moving very fast in that direction
mm-hmm.
for other individuals need it. We have emergency psychiatry at Doctors Hospital available. We have admission privileges these days, facilities as well.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And we have other psychiatrists working in the other community, and other doctors' hospital clinics as well, all the time. So we cannot say we didn't have access.
Right.
Okay. So all over the place, we are all over the place, psychiatry, especially these days in the Bahamas. And it's going to grow further.
Mm-hmm.
One of the fastest growing area
yeah.
in the Bahamas.
Yeah, I think that's a critical point. You know, just you just have to be willing to make the first move. Because you know, as your own individual self, you know, if you feel like you're off, if you feel like you've recognized some of the behavioral changes that you talked about, the ball really is in that person's court to make the first move. I think the idea of talking to a trusted friend as kind of a starting point is a good one, because if you don't feel like you want to, you know, jump all the way to coming into the clinic, at least start there. And hopefully as we do more conversations like these and we put more resources out there, people feel more comfortable engaging in that area of the health system, whether it's on the private side or on the public side. And it's good to hear that there's so many opportunities, and this the access is just so readily available.
And not only that, I mean, I'm sure most Bahamians, most individuals have their own favorite GP or family practitioner. And most of them are trained in psychiatry as well. Psychiatry. So feel free to have a chat with them as well. And they will definitely guide you in the right direction in case you're feeling overwhelmed and you don't want to talk to anybody else.
Okay, awesome. This has been a very good conversation, Dr. Boda. I'm very happy to have you on. I think this will be helpful for our listeners who, you know, as we talk about mental health, like I said, we're doing two episodes on this. So it's been a pleasure to have you on.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
All right. So for our listeners at home, we, as always, invite you to like, comment, subscribe, and share the podcast. And we'll see you back here next week on another episode of the Doctors Hospital Podcast.
Are you ready to transform your relationship with nutrition? Doctors Hospital's clinical nutrition services are your first step towards a healthier lifestyle. Let us shift your knowledge of what and how to eat for a vibrant, energized you. Visit us today and discover a new world of delicious, nutritious choices. Doctors Hospital's Clinical Nutrition, where every bite brings you closer to wellness. Ask your doctor for a referral today or call 302-4600 extension food for more information.